Welcome back, guys, to another episode of ProView. Thanks for your support. With a short time, we have reached a subscriber of 500 plus, and thanks very much for that.
Mohan sir, have you ever clicked birds other than tigers?
Of course. Not many numbers. I have done birds, definitely.
What would be the number? Chalo, let's come
hardly, hardly about 300.
Okay. So I'm slightly better because I started with my journey, a lot of bird watching and then bird photography. I'm close to 600, something like that, you know.
Wow.
So never counted, but I know that number. You know, Mohan sir, I mean, and for all the subscribers, Indian subcontinent has got more than 1300 bird species. And today we have a guest. I think in sheer numbers, she's one of the top ranking photographer who has photographed, not only seen her the number of birds seen or heard would be much more than that. But I guess the number is close to 1100.
Wow.
So let's welcome a very special guest, Jenny Maria. So Jenny,
welcome, ma'am.
Welcome.
Hi everyone, good morning. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I have known Mohan sir from a long time. So he is one of the person who had actually pushed me to take it to social media also. He used to tell me like, Jenny, why don't you just post your pictures in Facebook or, you know, all the other handles. But I was like very skeptical and, you know, I was very hesitant. But thanks to Mohan sir to bring me out into the social media so that, you know, I'm getting all this kind of good appreciation and kind words from all of you. So thank you so much for that.
Ma, Jenny, we are very happy and pleased to have you on our today's program.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining. And guys, Jenny, for those who don't know Jenny, she has done a doctorate in chemical engineering. She started her bird photography 10 years back. And since then, she is very, very passionate about birding. I have seen, if she gets a call that there is a particular bird there in some remote corner of India, next day she is there. That is her style. And thank you, ma'am, for joining.
Yeah, and ma'am, today when it comes to birds in India, basically Indian subcontinent, mm-hmm. be it the media, be it the magazines, the books, the research papers, I think everywhere we can see your contribution. Okay?
Thank you.
So glad to have you here. From a research background to now India's leading bird photographer, how that journey started?
It was not anything pre-planned. Obviously, I was like, you know, as a child, I used to be very interested in like photographs. My dad used to enjoy a lot of photography. He was working in Oman. So, you know, that time, every Keralaite, from every Kerala home, there would be like somebody in the Middle East. So my dad was working there and he was very interested in photography. So I've like grown up seeing cameras, different kind of camera. And also my dad's friend, his name is Krishna Narayanan actually. So we call him very fondly Krishnan Jetan. So he used to own a studio so we had access to that studio and, you know, different kind of camera, everything. And he used to tell me the importance of the light and all that. So it was as a child, I have heard all this and I liked also. And of course, I grew up in a very beautiful place, like a lot, very well-wooded place. So we were always a part of like, you know, grew up as a part of nature. So that way it was already there. But then you you go for your studies, everything, you don't have much time to take to the field, or you don't think about it basically. Then I, my first job here in Bangalore was like, you know, my, I joined the General Motors Research and Development here in Bangalore. So that time, we used to have this every Friday talks, technical talks, combined with like a high tea session with like, you know, random talks, any interesting topics like that. So one, my senior senior colleague, her name is Garima Bhatia. She is very well known in birding, and I consider as one of her, like, you know, as one of the mentors, like, all the time. So she was into birding that time. She just started, like, you know, she went to Goa and met some birders or, like, you know, something like that. And she came back with some very good pictures from Goa. So one technical talk session, when she presented, she showed this as the, like, you know, as the interesting topic which she had kind of come across. So nice birds. So just like that, I left it. Then another colleague, he went to Andamans and Nicobars or something like that. And then he came back with like one of his, Karthik Ramanathan, his name is Karthik. So he came back with like, you know, a beautiful picture of a collared kingfisher. So that blue and all that, you know, it looks so beautiful for me for the first time. Wow, nice. Like that, that was the first time I really thought of, like, you know, oh, birds and photographs, like that, you know, that moment when you feel that, okay, this would be good to go to bird photography or something like that, some random thought. And you might be knowing Amit Deepa Mohan, right?
Yes.
You know Deepa
yes.
Mohan. Yeah. So Deepa, then there are, like, you know, other birders in Bangalore, like, especially she coined you know, very jocularly a term called Bangalore Urban Ladies Birders. So bulbs, she used to call us bulbs. So we used to, like, generally go on Saturdays, Sundays outside. So Garima took me along for the first time. She just told, you come along like that. So we went like that. And then we started exploring Bangalore, you know, so-called outskirts here, there. And so that is how the journey started. So then after some time you get greedy, right? And then you go for some other birds, some other state or like whatever. That is how it had all started.
Officially, when you started, I mean, we all started as bird watchers first, okay? I mean, watching birds with the binoculars. But then that thing, you know, let me capture also. What is the first official camera or lens what you own? That's your
Initially, I started just with like, you know, binoculars or like, you know, but I didn't quite bird just with binoculars. I think immediately a time and a 100-400 Canon EF 100-400. That was my first kit combination.
Okay, and now what gear you own, ma'am?
Amit sir, sorry. Can you just repeat whatever happened? Just last 15 seconds, our voice was cracking.
Okay, ma'am, your net was okay. I'll just. So, ma'am, when you started your that bird photography, what is the first gear or the camera what you own when you started your bird photography?
My first camera, I think that time was like Canon 450D, the smallest. I think it was a kind of entry level camera. You might know. More than that, entry DSLR, but and a combination with 100-400 IS-1, the first lens, that zoom, that kind of lens. So that was my first combination, the kit, yeah.
And what is your current gear, ma'am?
Currently, I have like, you know, 7D. I mean, I just kept for different purposes. So Canon 7D, Canon 1DX, then Canon 1DX Mark II.
And lenses?
300. mm f2.8, Canon 300 mm f2.8, Canon 500 mm f4, then Canon 100 macro, then wide angle lens 16-35. So that is my kit, but I hardly use macro or wide angle because it's very difficult to carry all this along, you know. I have seen you guys carrying multiple lenses. I am not equipped to do that, so I don't carry. I carry one at a time. Maximum.
Perfect.
So congratulations, ma'am, for your new achievement, the Canon influencer. And we are really proud of you.
Thank you so much. I'm proud of that myself too. It was like with surprise news. So thank you so much, all of you, for that. Yeah.
Do you remember where we met first time?
Yes. How can I forget that? Yeah. And you asked me a very, very, like, you know, kind of funny and interesting question. So Amit, what happened is that I met him in Chiplun, okay?
Okay.
So he and like the great birders, like and photographers, obviously, like Prakash Ramakrishnan, happened to be another, you know, incidentally happened to be another Canon EOS influencer. Then Krishnamurti, then whom else was there? Like Saminathan,
Babu,
like that. You know, see, he comes with all these people. Okay, so I am like, you know, I don't have a tripod. I do not have the habit of using tripod. So these guys have come with like big bazooka lenses and tripod and all set up to take the picture of the Oriental Dwarf Kingfisher, Chiplun. That if you know, that place is famous for that, right? Or Nandu's place.
Yes.
So I am there with this kutti camera, like with the 300mm f2.8. The maximum range I can is put a 2x converter and get it 600. Okay. So anyway, Mohan sir is there and he introduced and I was, wow, like, oh, Mohan sir, because I've heard about him and also in INW everything. So I was very happy. And then I was showing in my mobile the pictures which I've clicked of the birds. Okay. Just swiping and showing. Then he's asking, really, did you manage all these shots with 300? Can you just imagine? He asked me that question. And like, you know,
I was really amazed. I mean, you had some brilliant images to show on that day.
And so I can't forget that incident, you know. He just asked me, like, you know, then I was, oh, yeah, I could totally afford this and I'm just managing with this. So that was my first, you know, kind of. Answer. It was so funny. I thought about it a lot later. Okay, he really asked me this. Did you just click all these pictures with 300 like that? Anyway, so that was my first meeting with Mohan sir. Yeah.
And now what's your go-to lens?
I always try to carry 500 because over time, Canon 500, for that over time, you know, I have developed that kind of reflexes. So even if we are going for red babblers, the way they behave, you know it very well. So red babblers are like, you know, fast moving birds, and then bush warblers, all these birds, even if I have in mind that I have to really put a lot of effort while clicking those, sometimes I tend to carry 300. But since I have developed this fast reflexes for like, you know, this many experience, I mean, this many, you know, kind of time spent in the field, I always think that I can manage with, you know, that confidence. With that confidence I go. So when I carry a lens, the go-to lens would be a Canon 500 F4, which I prefer. Yeah.
So in fact, I'm so excited to see all those stunning images, ma'am. So what I would request, without any further delay, can you please share your screen?
Okay, sure. So I have put together some images from like here and there. So something which I felt like colorful and like favorite. So let us start with the black-billed roller. So as we know, this is like one of the not so common now, I think, but we can see it quite often perched along the wires or, you know, in the northeast. But to get a good picture, it's always a little bit, you know, you have to be, Manas is a very good area. So I have been waiting for like, you know, a very good picture of this black-billed roller, something which you make other than the lines or the wires. So one of the trips in Manas, I was able to get this. So I really like the blue of this, you know, the unique combination of the Turkish blue and the Prussian blue and whatnot. And such a beautiful bird when it flies. That's why I put this image here. Then about Mandarin duck. So this is like one of the most beautiful ducks in the world, I think, along with the American wood duck. So, but I would probably like, you know, I mean, for me, it is like more this duck is more beautiful than even the wood duck. It was really a very beautiful time to go and shoot this. So this bird that came was like, you know, I think a straggled, a straggler or vagrant in the Andaman, in Little Andaman actually. So that time when I came to know about this bird, I could not go. And then Adesh had spotted it, I think. Adesh and Mandar were the people, like, you know, who had basically seen this bird for the first time. So when I got the news, it was like, you know, I was somewhere else, or, you know, I could not go. Then I was like really praying, oh my God, the duck should stay till I can go and see it. So then it stayed, fortunately, for almost a month. And then I was able to make this picture. So it was like directly dashing from the ship to the spot. You know, it was not so far, but it's like, okay, go like that. That you are there and the duck should be just there. You know, that moment of, you know, excitement happens like that, as we all know. So anyway, when we reached there only, it was like this bird was seen in the lake, a small lake with were full of water lilies. This pink thing, you can see the pink flowers are all like the water lily flowers. So it is like edging a village. The lake was edging a village and they had a fence. And the duck was just sitting there, you know. And the whole evening it didn't move from there. Oh. The next day morning also, I went and checked the bird and it was still there. And this morning session, all a full day, like I tried to spend, when it is going to come into the water, what is it going to do? Nothing. It just sat on the fence in the company of an Andaman teal, which was sitting just below the duck. So it was like that. And I was literally wondering, when does this bird feed? Because the whole day, the bird was sitting on that fence. It will be like whenever I go, I have my breakfast and I go, then also the duck is there. I have my lunch and go, then also the duck is there. So I was wondering, like, when is it going to be feeding? Then anyway, so we made some pictures and all that. And then we tried to go in the night to check whether it is feeding. So then the bird was not there. So we presume that probably the bird feeds in the night along with lesser whistling teals and all, because lesser whistling teals are known to feed in the night, even probably Andaman teal also. So we kind of arrived at the conclusion that probably this is feeding in the night along with the teals, because there were a lot of teals there. So that was a very interesting experience. We checked in the night. It was like very, very beautiful. So yeah, it's one of the unforgettable sightings.
Which month is this, Jenny?
This is in January. So this was January 2018, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, January 2018.
And this year it gives appearance in West Bengal?
This bird has very good records in actually Loktak Lake in Manipur. So a couple of times we have sighted there. This year, what we saw in Kolkata, probably like you saw a lot of images coming up was of wood duck, but probably it is an escapee because it's very far out of its range.
Okay.
And they are not too much known to migrate this. So I don't know, I cannot comment, but that is generally the opinion among all the birders and, you know, all the people who are like, you know, experts, considered as experts in this field. So that is, wood duck was seen, but I'm not very sure about a mandarin duck sighting in Kolkata.
Okay.
So Loktak is where Manipur is what we have a couple of records, more than that. And Bhutan had a couple of consecutive year records. Yeah. I think they had got a pair, if not mistaken, or a female only, one of them. And any time, I could not go. So I was like wishing for this bird to, like, you know, kind of be there, you know. I tried to go check in Bhutan, but I could not go because of some other thing. Then Loktak Lake, as if you are being there, it's like huge water body. And you don't know where exactly to look for, you know, such species, unless and until you have like regular monitoring happening there. And now there are some guys doing there, like Ranjit, then there is like one guy, Harmain, all these guys, because now it's a favorite spot for eastern grass owl too. So Manipur people are like exploring, but it's very difficult. So this was our best bet, you know, Andamans. Yeah, it was really good. So that is about this duck. Then this one, this is a golden bush robin. I really like the posture of this bird, you know, and it's a very stunning bird. Amit, you might have seen it. I don't know about Mohan sir, probably you also might have seen it. So
no.
This is like one of the beautiful yellows which we can see. So they breed in, I actually went to this place, Sela Pass, for in search of the gold's short wing, basically. The gold's short wing, it's one of the rarest short wings. So it's very beautiful bird, like drab, brown color. I should have put it, that image also here. Anyway, it's a very beautiful small one with like stellar pattern on its body. So I went for that basically. And when we were looking for this bird just came and danced in front of us. It was sort of displaying and it was very cool. It gave us a lot of time. So that is when this image was made. And it's one of my favorite images, you know, in that fog and mist, this yellow, it's like tail fanning up and all that. I felt it's really, really beautiful. Then moving to our very common bird in Ladakh, the black red star. So this frame I really like because such black bird, you know, sometimes you don't get such good frames on this. So like it was like merrily feeding on a sebac thorn plant. Oh, background, foreground everywhere. So to have such a beautiful background, I really like this picture. Then another one beautiful bird, which we have like a fire-tailed sunbird. So this one also, I remember I saw it for the first time in Menam Wildlife Sanctuary in Sikkim when we were birding Chevang. And you know Chevang, right? Yes. So we were birding and he just told me that's a fire-tailed sunbird. And then I was telling him, I cannot see a fire tail on it. So it was like a subadult, or it was not developing that, it had not developed that breeding, that streamers. So I just felt, okay, good. Anyway, and it was like kind of a drab bird, you know, like the female or like, you know, some not like as stunning plumage as this. Then anyway, I came to know about that bird, right? So we learn a lot of things when we bird, like, you know, from our friends and guides and naturalists. So he told me, like, you know, in the breeding time, they develop this beautiful streamers and all that. Then this became sort of a dream bird. And then I got a very good opportunity to make a picture in fog, again in Bhutan. So that was the first time I made that image. Like, it is literally on fire. The tail would be like this. So it was like the tail would be really on fire. That would be the impression we would get. So anyway, so that was the first time I made an image of that. And this was constituently from Tawang last year. So it was, they have this small juniper or pine trees kind of habitat if you haven't been there. So if you are in a higher elevation, you get a very good view of that. And then sometimes these guys just come and just flit around and it's very beautiful too. Make pictures at the right time. I think I was there about in May, April and May. So there were a lot of fire-tailed sunbirds out there. Then a tough customer, as you know, a long-billed bush warbler, long-billed wren babbler, sorry. So this also is a very, and wren babblers as a whole, always it is challenging to photograph birds. They kind of move around in thickets and very difficult to identifying call is more or less easy. Of late, you know, I can identify all the wren babblers call because they have like subtle differences. So it's easy to hear them calling, but most of the time it's very, very difficult to take photographs. I have real tension, you know, building up in me when I think of taking a wren babbler. It's like you hold your breath and you hold your lens so tight so that, you know, you just track the movement if possible through the thickets and then take a shot. It is really challenging. So is the case of like many Fulvetas, and also the spot-throated babbler is another toughest bird I have clicked. Like real tension, and the bush warblers. So these are like, you know, tensed kind of pictures. You know, you are tensed and you are like, you skip many beats of your heart to get an image of it. See the long-billed ring babblers, they perch quite open sometimes, and one of the easiest which I have felt yet. So then you can like make some good pictures. So this was shot on a 500 with a 1.4 DC, I think. So it was that close and it didn't move much. So that's why I was able to get a clear shot of it.
Jenny, one question from my side. See, there are certain birds where you, I mean, I've seen a lot of your images and you, I saw you in field, you don't use tripod much. But when you have this kind of situations where, you know, you anticipate, you know, this bird might move in the thickets or it might come in the open, you use a support system like a monopod or a tripod for this kind of images or shots?
No, I always do handheld shots. Not because that I have anything towards a monopod or tripod. Okay, given a chance, I like to use it. But the point for me is to carry everything. It becomes really cumbersome for me because in the Northeast, you are birded in Northeast very extensively, even much before even we started. So, you know it, the conditions, how it is. Like, you know, they move so fast that so for me taking a tripod and a monopod or, you know, going and trying to fix it, I think probably I'm not that dexterous enough to do that, or that is what I feel. I feel that's a hindrance for me to photograph. So, as I told you earlier, I started with a smaller lens, like, right, 100, 400. Canon, then I had a Canon 300 F4, which I felt more useful for birds. So I started doing handheld photography. Then I slowly increased, you know, the weight wise also, it just slowly, you know, kind of came up. So I have developed that reflexes and that stability, and I got basically habituated to, I think. So I am comfortable with using without a tripod, but what I do is that I, like, you know, make like continuous, I always use continuous shoot mode, because at least hoping that at least one will focus. So just because it affects my movement that I am not carrying a tripod or a monopod. Monopod would be a good option, but still that, you know, I have used it sometimes. I felt that it is again, you know, hindering my movement.
But you definitely have a very steady hand, I must say.
So it comes with practice, I think. You have not tried it, because probably when you started, you just started straight away with a tripod. So that is because you had probably a bigger lens. So, you know, you got used to that kind of clicking style. I think that is what happens. So once you are not you know, then what do? You don't want to carry a tripod or a monopod. Then what do? You shoot with your hands available. That is how it had happened. There's nothing pre-planned. But having said that, if you go to a hide of, like, you know, birds of paradise, then probably you need that as the number one thing you want to take, because of the low light conditions and like, you know, the lack of, you know, you need all the speed you want. So I have started using, I mean, I have a tripod, so I carry it only to such kind of places. So it's important. I have tried with hand shots. It comes, but you have to be really, really lucky to do that. Because sometimes we get some kind of light. So that time some birds, I mean, you can get some decent images. But most of the time when they display, it's really dark. So you need a hide to get, you need a tripod to sit in the hide, so that if you want to make video also you can do, and also a shot. So yeah, so such conditions you need a tripod for sure. Yeah. So then moving on to the next one. So this is also another interesting, beautiful species. It's one of the very beautiful warblers you can see. So I was like on the lookout for this bird for a long time. I think I might have searched for about 4 years or something before I made this picture. So usually when I go to Ladakh, it would be like, as we know, the birds are very sparse and sparsely distributed, right? So it's very difficult to see in a particular area, many many birds or something like that. So as we keep on doing birding, you get it's a moment. All the time I felt like Ladakh birding is like, you can expect surprises at every turn, and you can get all the wonderful shots, and you can come up with no shots at all. So that is how Ladakh birding is, and extreme conditions. Most of the time we have that oxygen, lack of oxygen issue and all that. But the birds which we see there, we can't see anywhere else. So that makes it very interesting and unique in Ladakh. So this one, as I said, like four years or something have tried. So I used to go to monasteries. That time, I used to ask all the local people, like, have you seen the small birds? And sometimes what happens is that I always carry book in such conditions. So even if they do not know the English name, so I leaf through it and I ask them, like, about the snowcock, about little owl, about all these birds. So they will tell that, okay, some monastery, somewhere it is seen. So from the books and the net and all, internet and all, I gathered that, okay, this is seen in Sebakthorn bushes. That much I was sure. But then Nubra Valley, you know, it's full of Sebakthorn bushes. Where do you look for it? So there were no much guides also, naturalists in that part of the world that time, not into birding much. Now you have seen like many people go up, like Rajesh is a very good person to take people for birding there, Rajesh Panwa. So that time I was like all alone, and I didn't get much support that wise, like, you know, about sightings, like recent sightings, nothing. So like that, it happened, it kept on happening. And what happened is that, like, me and Danesh, my husband, both of us were that on and that trip. So he said, okay, let's try. And he's also a very good spotter. So though he doesn't photograph and all, he likes to see birds. So he told, he will help me out. So both of us were birding. We birded for about 5 days in Nubra Valley. That entire area we tried. We will go, we will try, okay, this bush, that bush, whatever with available calls, I was trying everything. But no sign of it anywhere. Then we come back to Leh. So incidentally, that time, Praveen Jayadevan, you might know Amit, Praveen, yes. Jay, then Dibu, Dibu Karthadithab, all Vijay Mohan, and all these guys were there. They have just finished their birding. So I had called them up. I knew, you always get connected, right? You know, where, who goes and all that. At least 3-4 years back, we used to be like that. So I knew that they were there, and then we met up for dinner. And then Dibu was telling me, like, okay, there's a red-necked grebe there. That was red-necked grebe? Oh, I have seen it. Like that. I mean, just casually mentioning, oh, I had seen it. Then he asked me, where did you see it? I told him, Gujarat. Then we understood that I was mistaking black-necked grebe for red-necked grebe. Right. So then, wow, I felt like, wow, nice. So then I should be going for that, because it was just near the Leh airport, one lake. Okay. So that was one, lifer, which also I got in that trip, just because of this conversation. And then anyway, I told, okay, my God, I tried for the white-browed tip wobbler. I didn't get it. Then Dibu told me that, okay. I mean, both of them, I think Praveen also, they Garima and Rajneesh, they saw it last week in Panamik. So probably you might just want to talk to them. So I called up Garima from Leh, and she told me the exact place she saw it, okay? She told me this also. The bird will not respond, but it could just come up and then go off. So you just be ready for that. That's what she told. So I went again. Then I told Danesh that, okay, let's go to tomorrow again to Nubra. He was just so crazy. He was telling, really? You want to go back again? It's Garbhungala Pass. You're not just going just on a smooth road. You have to again go and then go to the area. And I told, okay, you don't come, I'll go. But anyway, he also came, being him being nice. So we reached that place around 9:30, and then that is how, so he was helping me playing the call, and I was trying to focus on the bushes, whether it pops up and all that. Anyway, we didn't see it. Then she just went to the car for something else. And then, so I had my phone in my hand. I had my camera in the right hand. I just played, you know, when you are just standing there, you have the habit of sometimes playing, right? I just played and this came up. And then, you know, I had like left hand a phone and the right hand camera. And fortunately, it was 300. And like out of the 5 shots, like one became sharp. And that was this image. And Danish came back seeing me clicking this. Then he was telling me, really? You managed it? Wow. Like that is what he told me. So he was also very happy. So that was how this shot happened. And it's one of my favorite shots in terms of the hard work. And it's such a beauty to see, you know. But later I figured out that in the month of December and January, this is much more easier because it can be seen in, like, you know, if you play the call, they would be around. They're not so shy as in like June, July. So that is another good thing. So you need to basically continuously go to some places to see the species when they are active, when they are not. So let's explore the places. We have that problem. So now we have a lot of birders, so we keep on getting such good information. So that's about this bird. And this one, I like this shot a lot. You know, I've been trying to shoot the Demoiselle crane for a long time, and it's not a tough bird. We know that in Gujarat, Rajasthan and all, there, like, you know, you can see them in thousands, especially like in the winter months. But I was not able to single out an individual and photo, I take a photograph. Okay, so this time in January 2019, I think we went for some oriental practicing cold images and all that. So Isha was there. So that day she didn't come, but Isha was kind of helping me out with the all the birds there. So this particular day in the early morning, just crack of the dawn, this sole fellow was feeding in a big, field. And then that time also I had 500 in my hand. So it was alert, but I could really approach it very closely. And I really like the feel of the ambience. It's so early in the morning. So you get that, you know, kind of, fog and mist, fog that is settling, and as well as the ground, I was just in a lower, the bird, I could really see it in eye level. So that is how this shot was made. So it's one of my favorite shots. And definitely a graceful bird it is. I really like these cranes. So this one, a black baza. So we all know that it's a very sought after cute tiny raptor which we can see. So in Thattekad it is normally easy to see for sure in the winter months. But then, you know, I was not able to see this for a long time. I was not able to make a picture in the ground level. Or in the eye level. So this time it was like perching somewhere like closer, not so close. I had put a 2x on 500, but I am happy about this image because all those tiny features can be seen except from the underbelly. So whatever it is, I like that feather pattern and all on this bird. So I really find this image so beautiful. At least for me. See, for me, when I see the images, I think I am the person who enjoys the maximum rather than, you know, somebody else or any other person enjoying it. Like, it's for me. That is what I feel more happy about it. And
One question from my side. When you actually see the bird for the first time, you really started seeing the bird, enjoying the bird first, or you first, your hand goes on your trigger?
It's both. I'm a birder as well as a photographer, right? So what happens is that, you know, when I'm in search of a lifer, my heart will be, oh my God, just let me see it. Let me see it. So it's like, just for me, want to see it. And when I see it, then it, you know, immediately you have a kind of that feeling, right? Okay, this is that bird. So then I do not carry a binocular, right? Because of this, heavy gear, I would have a binocular in places like, you know, in Gujarat and Ladakh, where you need to really see closely. So that is the only time I carry the binoculars, but it will be still in the car or, you know, when I want to take it out, then only I will. So when I see a bird, what I do is that, okay, I will have that from the appearance, oh, this could be that. That the first thing which I want to see is through my camera. I use camera to see it because it's a telephoto. So you get that zoom. So that is how I see it, like, you know, to make sure that it is that bird. Then, you know, automatically it's easy to click, right? It is not so tough to, you know, so I use it as an equipment to for me to see as well. So that is how it is. So when I click it, I first see the bird, I just click it, and then I slowly, slowly approach to improve the photograph. That's how it is. So this is like a, you know, a combination of a birder and a photographer, I think. So it is not like exactly the perfect photo I don't need. I need the photo, whatever it is, or I need to see the bird. But I don't need that perfect kind of photos or, like, you know, very good background or something like that. When I first see the bird, it's somehow, I'm sure, I should be sure that it is that bird. That is my, it's kind of ID features or characteristics of that bird should be seen. That is what my first target would be. But since you asked that, the moment of the greatest moment of joy for me would be, like, you know, when I see the bird and when I am about to click the bird, right? You are sure that you're going to click it, right? Yeah. That is the moment of joy, you know? Okay. Wow, finally, like that is the feeling which you get. So it's like that moment of clicking gives me the maximum joy, I think, that feeling of, like, you know, satisfaction, then hard work coming into fruition, you know, all that kind of feeling, right? That mixed feeling, all I enjoy in the field, not that when I see the image later. Very so anyway, this is a black-browed bush-tit. It's a very rare bird. We have to go to Palong in that area to see it. Yes, yeah, that is one of the time, first time when we went to Valong, we basically tried to look for this bird, and Valong is basically famous for three birds. This bird, black-browed bush-tit, then black-headed greenfinch, and the Godlewski's bunting. So these three birds, we generally do not have any record outside. We have a couple of them, I think, of late, but it's like, you know, most of the time, a reliable place to go and see these birds, as you probably know, Amit, that Valong is the place. So we went for that bird first, and we were coming from that. So first we saw this bird, the tit, and then we saw the bunting, and then we saw the And when we were starting to climb down, we saw the that time. So we had the right place. So that is how that species got added to the India checklist. So that was one beautiful thing which had happened in Malang. Then tawny owl, this is like one of my dream bird, which I made a picture of, like, you know, after many, many years. This is one of the last few owls remaining for me from the subcontinent rather. So this one, like, during my first visit to Ratchikam, I had seen this, okay? Like, we were trekking down and then we just saw it so close. Like, there it gets darker only by, in the month of June, July, it only gets darker by 7:45, 8 p.m., right? So it was like faint light and I could see the gray of the bird. So it was very, very beautiful to see it. But I was just wondering, what would I do? I just had a camera for sure, but I was not equipped with a night photography. I didn't have flashlight, flashes on the camera. I mean, flash inbuilt was there, but then also I didn't carry a torch or the flashlight, nothing. So all I could do was to enjoy this bird. And I asked, like, Nasir Malik, he was there with me, one of the very knowledgeable people in that area. So he told me that it's a tawny owl. Okay, it's a tawny owl. That's for the first time I'm hearing the name, okay? That's just way back in 2010. It was not like, that was time I was a very novice birder that time. So tawny owl, okay, are you sure? Then he said, yeah, sure, like that. The way he speaks is like that, you know, very calmly he will say, yeah, I'm sure it's a tawny owl. Okay, fine. I'm happy anyway, I'm looking at it. So just a meter away from me, you know, eye level, full view. Any birder's dream, you know, for the night, nocturnal photography. That is how the bird was sitting. But I could not make any picture. I just saw that And another, it was a pair. Another one was calling from a little behind. But so this call scenario was going on, and I am watching the bird very helplessly. I enjoyed it, and then I come back, and I tell all this birders, and they are like very happy. Oh, you really saw it? Then I think Atul Jain had not went to try in Dachigam to see it also. I think they also missed whatever happened. Anyway, from that moment onwards, it's like it became a prestigious issue for me to kind of see this bird and click it to make sure that I've seen that bird there. You know, sometimes like you feel that, you know, you want to make sure that you've seen it like that. So then I like 8 years went by. Then in last 2018, that too, after 2-3 trips, first I went in February when I went to look for the orange bullfinch. So after the clicking the bullfinch, I was like kind of free for 2-3 days. So just exploring about this bird, we were not able to find it. And again in September, Tatekard Danish, he joined me. He's one of the best for the owls, right? So to see and spot, he is one of the best I've seen. So he and Suresh Laman sir from Trivandrum, he was also there. So both of us were birding and looking for this owl. So that day also we heard the call, but we are not able to see it. You can see the color of this the bird. It's like you see generally the oak trees and the elm trees there, so the bark of the tree and the bird's feather becomes really camo, that it's very hard to spot it. So finally we could see one individual and two individuals rather, and I think I enjoyed it through the video of Suresh Laman sir like anything. It is just looking like so beautiful, as if it's like a pearl, you know, it will just crack and fall. That's the feeling you get in when you look through the video or Zoom video this bird. So I really enjoyed that, and that was the time when we clicked this bird after some 8 years of continuous searching.
Since we are on owls and normally you can photograph them in the night time, mm-hmm. What is your way to go in terms of light? Do you use that torchlight to lit them, or you use a flash?
Yeah, nowadays I use a flashlight, a torchlight. So we have these, I forgot the brand name and all now. Oh my God, I have two of them. It's been not used for quite some time, no? So that's why I'm forgetting it. So anyway, so I use an external source of light now. So I think it works for me. Basically, what I do is that I anyway do handheld. So I do not use converters because I've understood that converters will not give you any speed. So even with a 500, I think my maximum shutter speed I get is like about 1/80. Most of the old shots which I've seen, it's all I shoot in AV more, aperture priority. But still, when I see the examining the pictures, I come to know that's just shutter speed is around 1/80. So what I do is that helps. A flashlight is all I require. I mean, I use, and I try to not to focus on the eyes. So it would be somewhere below the eyes, so that the entire bird lights up. And if you are steady enough with the camera, I think you can can see it is okay, but it is not that feather wise you cannot count and all that. So you get, for me, it doesn't matter that it's tack sharp, but something to look at and to enjoy is what I'm looking for. So that way it works perfect for me in the night. Okay, so now about Ceylon Bay Owl. This is also a story of many years and finally getting this. So that time, incidentally, I was in Kerala. Okay, I was in my home. So that time, Sudish Tatekar, he called me. So three, I think couple of times I had gone with him, even for in those center. Obviously, he is the first person whom you really go. He's a go-to person for all the birds in Kerala, for example. He has, even if he has not seen it, he has definitely read about it and he will give you the information. So anyway, Eldos was the first person to, you know, introduce me to this species on a casual chat, actually. He told me, Jenny, we can try for Ceylon Bay out. And I thought, wow, what is that? So that is how it started from long time back. Anyway, so we tried and we could not get it. And then one day when I was in home, Sudhish calls me. Thinking that I'm basically in Bangalore, okay. He was telling like, okay, ma'am, we saw this Ceylon Bay Owl now in the morning. Do you think that whole day it will be there? But do you think that you'll be able to reach? And I was like, wow, really the bird is there? And he said, yes, we are able to see the day perch. Until the nightfall, it will be in the same perch. If you are able to come, we will try to somehow make it like that. And I told, I am in home. I'm in Kerala. I can reach there in 1 hour. Please make sure the bird is there. Please don't disturb it. Please don't go near it. You know, that kind of instruction, you come out of your excitement, you tell your guides, right? Please make sure that nobody goes there. Please make sure that you don't go there, you know, all this kind of thing. So anyway, within 1 hour, Godspeed, I reached there. That time I had a small, that. So when I used to travel that light to Kerala and all, like, carry that smaller 300 f/4. I had that lens that time. So that was the only lens I had. And when I saw this bird, I was like, oh my God, I could have carried the bigger lens. But anyway, that was the first time I clicked about it. And then also I realized one particular point that time. Wherever you go, you carry your best gear. Because you don't know what you get. Even if you're going home, something should come, might come up. And then you don't, you miss that, you know, that reach sometimes. So that was when, you know, I clicked that image for the first time. This is made much later. It is with the 500 F4 in the night. So that is how I really, really adored this bird. For first time when I heard the call of the bird, I just could not believe that's an owl calling. You know, it is like such a sweet, melodious call. Have you heard it, Amit?
Never.
So, yeah, it is like, it's very, very sweet. So is the case with the Oriental Bay Owl also, in what we see in the Suraipung, Jaipur area, and also in Manipur, Mizoram and all that. It's a very light note difference, but it's very, very cool kind of call, you know, it's like whistle, very beautiful. You don't think that, okay, it's an owl calling, you know, that way. What we hear generally is used to hearing calling like of jungle owlet, then all the spotted owlet, they have that harshness, screechy kind of feel, right? This is not like that. It's very, very sweet. So that's one very beautiful call this bird has. Then snow partridge, this is like, you know, one bird which I was searching for quite a long time. Not because I was not in the right place, right time. I had been there, but I was not able to find it. So like this time also, like in December, 2015, had a month-long trip with Rafiqul Islam, and we had a wonderful trip. So we started covering almost all the birds which I had in my list pending. So what we were doing is that we were going on the fly. Like if you are finishing one target, we were just moving to the next location rather than any pre-booking or something like that. We just went by faith, you know. Okay, whatever it is, we'll see on the way. So one of that in that trip, we were looking for this bird in Sela Pass, because Rafiq had seen it many times in Sela Pass. He said he has, like, most of the time, 90% of the time he has seen it, but I have always missed it. So we were looking for it, and then we were not able to find. When our driver suddenly called us. Padamji, so he called and he told, ma'am, there is something moving there. I think it is snow partridge. Dekho, please. Like that, he told. So it's like, when we go there and see, so Rafiq has anyway binoculars with him and I have the camera and both of us are zooming and we saw this. And indeed, it was like a flock of like 15, 20 birds, you know. And then once you see the bird and if you carefully approach this bird, we can go very close to this bird. Maybe a meter or 2 meter. Like that, they will stay. So I've shot this bird like that twice. So it is very possible if you really carefully approach it, because I think probably they believe in the strength and the unity. I don't know. Whatever it is, they would be there, and they are just, if you are not too much intruding the space, and if you're approaching it very slowly, you can make very close pictures if you want. Escape pictures also, of course. Then Amur Falcon, everybody's dream. Yeah.
One question.
You want to ask something?
Yeah, one question before you actually move out. Regarding the Northeast, what is the best month
you can
visit to shoot birds there?
You are asking me this? My God, I'm sure. I'm thinking, I'm assuming that you've been there like more than, the times which I've been. Anyway, to answer your question, it is like I have found February to April as the best, April, May as the best. But the point is that most of the time what happens is that February to April, everybody would be eyeing for the Northeast, right? So generally like places get crowded because I'm a person who really do not want too much of crowd especially when you're looking for some birds, if you are like, you know, I mean, sometimes you have to use the calls. So I am not a person who use calls a lot, but sometimes we have to use it to see the birds. So imagine a situation when you are calling a bird and another person is calling, or like, you know, I don't like that kind of a situation which happens in the field. So February through April, I've seen the places, almost all the places are as a bit like kind of crowded birding wise. So I try to go like towards the end of the season or beginning of the season also. So in the, after May, if you go to Northeast, it's a risk. You know that it could be raining.
Yes.
Many days we could just, you know, kind of get washed out and all that. So take that, I mean, I try to take the chance, but sometimes you get that unique kind of shots also. You know, sometimes you get those kind of sightings which are like unique also. So it's a mix up. So I try to do the trip in that time, but not exactly in that time. So
See, that question coming to us, I have never visited Northeast in winter. Have you went birding in winter in Northeast?
Yes, December 2015. What do you think it was then? So it is like a very hard winter, and especially like, you know, December towards end and all, it becomes really very especially the passes and all is full of snow, right? Mayodhya also after November, even to ride, take the car, it's very difficult. So I've birded in that conditions. And especially I've been successful in getting very good bird also, Temminckxia gopan, which is like, you know, they do not basically respond to any call or anything in that month. But then I was able to see it after I trek. But I think it is a little bit difficult. But when we get birds, we probably get it good. That is, you know, it's all a chance, you know. So I've birded extensively in the Northeast in December, November to January I've birded. So it's not that tough. You would be cold, but the point is, you know, sometimes you need to go for that in that kind of situations. So
Jenny, the only difference between your photography and our photography, you know, we just go there for a week. Okay. And we try to get everything, but the way you dedicatedly work on your subject, and that is what making you stand out from rest of the crowd, because Northeast is always a challenge about season, about the low light, high ISOs, and scarcity. I mean, you can't just spot it like that, you know. So, but your images are out of the world. Thank you so much, Jenny, for sharing this khazana with us.
But then Amur Falcon, like this is also very, very interesting. Okay, I wanted to make a shot of this bird for a long time. Okay, so finally we reached this the place where we get to see it in lakhs, whatever. So at least 10,000s of thousands or multiples of 10,000s. We got there in Pamti Valley in Doyang, near Doyang Reservoir, and we saw all this like huge flock. But they were not like, you know, giving a good shot from the watchtower which they had kept out there. So then we took a small boat and then climbed up a small hill, and then it was like a beautiful tree where these birds were like were feeding from the reservoir and coming and kind of perching on this tree eye level, because we had to climb that. But it was not a very hard climb. So whatever it is, so I sit there for like about 3-4 hours and make all sorts of frames possible. You sit at a particular point and you have a flock of birds coming in and going, then you have a lot of time, right, to make whatever shots you want. So that is how I made this. And then I come back. This was in like December, okay? November end. And then we come back. And then when we come back, we hear this bonanza of 16, 17 Amur Falcons in Palakkad. You remember that, Mohan sir?
Yes, yes.
God, you might have got, yeah.
So Malampura.
Malampura, yes, Palakkad, Malampura, whatever. So then I come back and hear this news. Wow, it is at our backyard. And then I, but you know, seeing in this many numbers and getting so much of shots, different backgrounds, flying, whatever, it was very amazing. So, but then I couldn't resist going to Malampura also, you know. I went again when I went back to Kerala in Christmas, during Christmas, after the Christmas when we were coming back from my home, we went to Malampura and clicked the image of the Amur Falcon and came back. So that was the same year. That was in 2016, December, right? Yeah, November, December, yes.
Yes.
But then this one of these beautiful birds, we all know where to go for this, Dita Kanika in Orissa and West Bengal Sundarbans. So I really like this image and one of the beautiful kingfishers which I have seen. Then this one, grey peacock pheasant, anybody's dream. So as we know, this bird is more vocal and more heard than seen actually. So I've missed this bird like between cup and lip many December months birding, right? So in the Jaipur forest area, we saw this, we heard this call, okay? It was very vocal. Then Rafiq told, let us try getting this bird map. And we just tried to just go a little bit off path and we tried waiting for it. And as he guessed, you know, the bird came because we just, you know, we were in that area. Then I saw that both of us were there, you know, Rafiq was also there and we were just placed a little far from each other and then we were just trying to click this bird. The bird really came so close and just when I was about to click, raise the camera, it just got spooked, it went off. Mm-hmm. That shy it was. It was like, it was totally alert and it is the next. Extremely alert bird. That day I found out that. Then again, you know, that feeling is so depressed. Just because of a camera, they could not manage like that. You can't digest that fact, you know, for some time it will be there. And then again, one more time, we tried in the same time. So what happened is that I was taking the cover of a tree and Rafiq was on another tree, the cover of another tree. So both of us could see each other. And we were waiting for this bird when we heard the call again. And then I was trying to move myself minimum so that, you know, I am only scanning through my eyes, you know, like 360, whatever angle I could, like through the specs or whatever I am trying to see, whatever angle is possible. Rafiq is also looking for the bird. And when the bird came, I didn't see it. Rafiq saw it, okay? It was just close to Rafiq. When I couldn't see it because such a different drab colored bird in that environment, it's very difficult. So I couldn't see it. And then he knew that I was not able to see it. I'm not safe. If I see the bird, it's a sure shot picture. He knows that. He knows that. So he just tried to make like this kind of small, this thing only. It was the second miss in the second day. And that two good misses, you know. So it stayed with me for a long, long time, you know, till I clicked the bird. But still that has not gone from me because when you miss the shot, that will really, really kind of etched onto your heart, I think. You know, when you miss very important birds, it always stays with you forever. So then when I was looking for blue pitta in Mizoram, we went for blue pitta, but then we could not see the blue pitta. We were walking in the Dampa forest area when we heard the call. And similarly, so for the two times I have this experience anyway that I know that this is going to happen. So what we did was that I went so far and I took a cover behind a tree and I didn't move at all. It was like so far and it was a like nice forest road. So it was a clear view. So I didn't move and I waited there almost about half an hour or so. And slowly the head appeared. Then also I didn't click. I was peaceful. I didn't want to make any problems there. So I just, you know, kind of was waiting. Then slowly the full body came. And I think a couple of shots I clicked. And that's it. So that is how they made this image. It's one of the most beautiful birds I've seen. You know, that blue, that that eye of the feather and all, know that ocellar plumes, it looks so brilliant blue, you know, violetish blue. And I really felt that it was so beautiful. The light was just falling on the back of it. So that is how we saw this bird. Then this is another really a bird which tested my all kind of, you know, mental, physical abilities, like, you know, my thinking, everything, you know. This is one of the toughest birds I have
played. And I believe this is your favorite bird, is it?
It is one of my favorites. It's not that it is one of my favorite because of its, like, you know, stunning plumes. It is like a wow bird. But equally, I have, like, you know, struggled for many birds. But this was, like, in terms of physical exertion, the maximum. Extreme physical exertion. If you have been to Great Himalayan National Park, the point is it's always a steep climb. You know, you don't have much level walk anywhere. You need to, even when you camp, you are like at an angle. When you sleep in at an angle. You know, you don't have that kind of... That is the setting we have in GHNP. So first time we went, Dr. Abhinav Chaudhary was there. So we did a lot of groundwork. He's a very good birder based from Dharamshala in Himachal, a practicing doctor, physician as well. Both went together. We spent a week in one of the best locations for this bird in Great Himalayan National Park. We didn't hear the bird at all. We didn't hear, we didn't see, nothing at all. And so frustrating. Came back. And then probably we thought it's very, very difficult bird. Okay, both of us like felt, okay, we have to really devise some plans to see it. Like that, we just came back. And then within the next week, we saw a beautiful image from James Eaton of the Bird Tour Asia. You might know Amit.
Yeah.
So James, James's image, excuse me. So it was from Dharangati National Park, okay? So what happened was that he could not go to GHNP or whatever, or maybe he might have done some groundwork, and probably the density or the population of these birds is better in Dharangati. It's the other side of the national park.
Yeah.
So he got back after 10 days and then he told me that he saw the bird twice and he got a shot also. Like, you know, far but beautiful. Then I felt, wow, so really this bird exists. You know, that is the first thing which goes on in our mind, you know. You know that the bird is there, but the Dhiman and Arnold shot this bird much before, right? Like about 4 or 5 years before. So I was thinking, like, probably this bird doesn't exist in that numbers, because when we came back also, we saw a hunted part. We saw, I don't know whether it was hunted, but we only saw the head portion. And it was like, it appeared to us it was hunted. So probably, like, you know, so that was the kind of idea we had, that it's probably hunted and very less in numbers. So when we saw James's picture, we thought, okay, my God, wow, it exists. Okay, there's a possibility. You feel that, okay, it's an, I took it as an impetus to go again, you know. So the next year again, Abhinav was busy, Dr. Abhinav was very busy. So anyway, we had devised a plan. So incidentally, we had a spoon-billed and a sandpiper and a mast of in-foot exploration in Bangladesh. So we had seen that bird, and what had happened is that Saim was a researcher and one of the best who has studied about finfoot and spoonbill sandpiper. He agreed to take a few of us. Ramki was there, Ramki Srinivasan, then Jan Musica was there. So it is very difficult to organize such trips to Sundarbans, especially you need at least 6-7 days, and it becomes extremely expensive. So what Siam had done was that put together, like, you know, interested people together, and then he that is how he conducted the trip, and we had amazing sightings of both the finfoot and the sandpiper. So during that trip, this conversation happened about this Chagopan and all. So Jan, Ramki had already left. So Jan was very interested. He was also wanting to see this bird. So that is how the second trip got materialized the second year. So again, we went there, like, about again 1.5 hours. We were, for 7-8 days we were looking for this bird. Every day early morning we will climb and then we will come back, and then we heard the call. The first day we heard the call, and Jan was telling he saw the bird, the female bird also. So he's like a very person who can manage, like, you know, very good weight, and also he can track that kind of stamina level he had. And for me, it was so difficult. I mean, when I heard that he had seen the bird, I was happy that, okay, the bird is there. But then it's a possibility for us to make pictures, right? So then anyway, so he used to go in one direction with a couple of people, or like, you know, sometimes he used to have his own GPS and he goes, and I with, like, you know, a couple of other guys in some other direction, wherever, you know, possible, like that. This happened, like, kept on happening for 6 days. And for me, no sighting, no nothing, call is there, but no sighting. So I felt practically that it is extremely impossible to make this picture. Because what was happening is that any slightest rustle, which we could, because of our footfalls, were, like, you know, alerting all the Himalayan manals off and the cockless pheasants. So everything was taking off. I have not seen such a population of Himalayan manals anywhere, you know. And these guys do not only walk on the ground. They just, you know, kind of, they trot on the ground, and when they get spooked, they fly and they sit on the top of the pine trees and keep on calling. So every pheasants in that area was getting on alerted. So that was happening. So just very, very difficult to think, to devise a strategy to make a picture with my minimal kind of, you know, facilities and opportunities. So I told Prashant Chauhan, he had organized. So I told him that, okay, please, if I am able to extend the trip, can you extend it? Because I don't want to again come and try for this bird, because it's all already a steep climb up. So again, next year, I don't want to, you know, go through at least this climbing process. So I requested him, can we stay another week itself? That was a frustration level, you know, when you go and try this bird every day, day in and day out, for 7 days, this is what happens to us. Then finally, the seventh day, what happened is, like, you know, we started early in the morning. Our idea was to locate the bird, like, when it before it comes down for feeding in the dawn, it gives calls. That is what we have gathered. So early in the morning, around 2:33, we started from the camp. So this time, Jan and me were together. Okay, so we had this plan. Okay, when the bird comes out of the tree, wherever, we hear the call, and then we sit somewhere in the open, and somewhere we can see the bird in the open, and when it comes out of the tree, we will click whatever it is. That is what our strategy was. But the strategy didn't work as earlier, as, like, you know, everything, like, monals were going off and nothing like that. So we started going, coming back. Around back by 11, he was already in the camp. I lost my way. Search party came for me, and then, you know, they got me back, because he walked very fast, and he didn't, you know, probably, like, you know, he watched some birds that he might have just, you know, he forgot that, you know, one person is behind. And I didn't have any GPS with me. I didn't have anything. So practically, I lost my way, and I was very scared also, because that is frequented by a bear. Himalayan black bear and brown bear also. I was very scared. Like, you know, that eerie feeling happens in you. Oh my God, if I had in my home, I had been in my home, I would have been alive. All this kind of things happens, you know, that you lose your way in the forest. This is what happens, that spooky, eerie feeling. So whatever it is, when this, he reached back the camp, the people, they knew that I am not there. So then they started, like, cooing and, like, you know, like that. After some time, I also heard them, and that is how they got me back. Then after some time, around 1 o'clock, Jan came back with a picture of this bird. Imagine. So that is how he came back with a picture of this bird. Not so very clear shot, but it's a picture and it's a bird. Oh my God, it's a mixed feeling which you go through, you know. You didn't see even the bird, and the other person is coming with all this picture. And I was happy for him, obviously, but I also wanted to see it. And then he told, like, you know, this is the cliff area which we have seen it. In the afternoon, I'm planning to go again. If you want, you can join me. So that is what, anyway. So I again went. We thought, okay, that is how it is. So he actually believes in my capability of getting the subject photograph, that he has seen it in spoon-billed sandpiper. So the strategy works well, that way he knew. So anyway, we climbed, and it's such a steep climb. I was not able to kind of gather it at all. It is like so steep. So the camera also you are carrying, right? You don't want anybody to minimize the footfalls. You are telling all your guides to sit at one place and you are going. So finally we reached one place, and it was a clearing, and then there was a fallen log, and we thought, okay, we will sit behind it because the bird should not see us. So so we heard the call, then we waited. So Jan was also like very cooperative. So he said, okay, we will not make so many calls. We just wait. We will give time. Then after half an hour, we spotted the two birds down. So it was like the female bird and the male bird both, but the female bird appeared to be very shy. So they were coming towards us. So the female bird disappeared in between. And I didn't want to click it at all unless and until it's a reasonable distance. Because that moment, I don't want it to, do anything stupid, and then the bird flies off and we end up with no shots. My previous experience teaches me that. So I told Jan also, let us get it in the frame and then we will click. So we were in a very good understanding, and then the bird, he was carrying a 600 mm and mine was 500. So when the bird was like in the reasonable range, it was like almost full frame shot of the 500. It had come, it was very inquisitive. It didn't see us. Only it heard was our camera click sound, and that too we, both of us clicked in burst mode. And so that is how we clicked this image. I mean, it's so fortunate and so happy that we finally got it. So that is like the story behind this bird. Yeah, that's one of the so that also one thing which had so much of thought process had gone in, at any kind of situations I didn't want to miss. So what had happened was that in that time there, sometimes it was the sun was going off in the clouds, and so it was getting dark. Then it was like sometimes foggy, it was sometimes drizzling. So this for this shot, I had actually put auto ISO mode, I didn't want to miss it at all. So it was like completely auto-ish with me just clicking the shutter. That was all what has happened. I think it is picked up around 6400 ISO, but I'm happy for that, whatever it is. So then Chia pheasant is another beautiful bird, which you can see. It's a near endemic bird, which we see in Uttarakhand and NCR, as you know. Then snowcock, this Tibetan snowcock, as I told you, sometimes we get really lucky. So this was my first trip to Ladakh. I saw this bird, in Tibetan snowcock. So we were going, taking a turn, and then this was near, perched on the top of a boulder. And there were 6-7 of them, and they were alert, and it was like curious, but not so shy. So we made a lot of shots. And I did not know that time what was a snowcock. That was the great funniest part of it. I knew that it was a bird I clicked. I was so happily clicking it because I have not seen that bird. Then I come back and I see the checklist. Oh, this is Tibetan snowcock. Wow, fantastic. Then I come to know that, okay, now I have only one snowcock to see, one more snowcock to see. That is the Himalayan snowcock, right? Then that greed happens, right? Okay, now I have to see the Himalayan snowcock. So that luck didn't favor. For Himalayan snowcock, I had to literally try about 5 years over different time frames to get a shot. So this is this Tibetan snowcock, it's an image which is made much later, not the original image. But for the snowcock, Himalayan snowcock, I literally had to struggle. I tried it in Spiti, in Mud Valley, many places, hoping that the birds will come to drink water. All those attempts failed. And finally, I got it in 1 April, and like around 30-40 birds at a single time. So sometimes we have the luck, sometimes we have to really, really kind of struggle for it. But it's a mix of all that. So then Andaman wood pigeon, it's their state bird. Of the Union Territory. So this also usually and also heard that it's been hunted a lot, but this was like, we got really lucky and I could see it in the Kachal Island, quite close. So that's one image. Beach Sydney is another very difficult bird to get sometimes. But once you spot it, and if you carefully approach it, you can approach within like a meter distance. So this also was a very difficult bird. There is some more stories behind it. At some later point of time, we can go through that. It's a lot of stories. Nicobar Scopsaul, one of the first photographs of this bird from our country. So I was one of the fortunate enough to be one of the first birders to go to that archipelago. Anyway, we didn't have any information about this bird at all. So we had to just, I have the habit of like, you know, of going for the night birds or night mammals. I got this habit from Shivang Amit, because he used to be very, very much interested in the mammals, small mammals in the Northeast. So I've seen him initially when I started birding and all, I didn't have much interest in mammals. But I've seen him going for like looking for squirrels and all that. So, you know, when you have a naturalist along with you, looking for night mammals, you feel that it's a good thing, and then you get that habit. So that is how I got it from Shivang, basically. So I'm thankful for that. So one of this like that. So we have then I developed it as a habit to explore, especially in the unknown places. So we just went for like, you know, a night kind of birding. So Vikramshil was along with us. He's also very good for owls in the night. So he just kind of scanned the forest fringes with the flashlight. That is how he does, and he found that. It was seen, like, you know, it was close to the road, so both of us could see it very closely. That is how this image was made. Similarly, this one, we had no information. We knew that Andaman Nicobar species, I mean, especially the Nicobar species of the Oriental Scopsaul, is fully rufous in color. And so I wanted to see that for quite a long time, but then we were not able to see it. And we didn't have any information on this either. So again, like, you know, when we had the night birding, Danish was there with me that time. So he was like, you know, picking up. We were trying for all the calls possible. We were trying for Oriental Scopsaul call. The call of this bird is so different. It is not at all anywhere close to any Oriental Scopsaul bird call I've seen. I've heard it in the Northeast. It's different from what we hear it in the South. But this is like, you know, very squeaky kind of call. So we heard this call and then we stopped the vehicle, and the Danish just could figure out where the call was coming from. That's how we got the species also. So probably we don't know whether it's a new one. So we have to wait and watch for that. So I think Shashank and all is working on this. So yeah, Hoxhill's dropout. This is also very one of the sought after birds in the Northeast. We have two frog mouths, as we know. So one is in the Ceylon, and this one it is as of now, I think off late, not as of now, off light, off late. We have a lot of good sightings coming from Northeast, especially from the Mishmi Hills and also from Jaipur forest area. Sorry, I think I am missing it. Not Jaipur, Lat Panchar. So they have like, you know, a daytime photographs, and also I think there was a nesting which was found a couple of years back, if I'm not mistaken. So the habitat of the bird is well known, and people are like more aware of this bird. So, but first time when I saw this bird, it was like in 2014 in Namdafa. So we heard the call of the bird again. We tried to look for it, and after 2-3 days, we saw the female. But so female bird was like very close to the road. And then when we just, you know, kind of listened, there was another bird calling, and then we found the male morph, male bird, and the gray morph actually. So it was like, I think one of the first photographs of the bird made during that time. Of male for Hoxhill's rock mode. So that way it was very good. And after that, there's been several sightings of this bird for me. So this one was like from Mishmi, but I think I'd seen it in Mizoram in very good numbers, and also in very good numbers. So it is not that rare if you really look for it. And if you know how to approach and how to know to get it out, then we can see this bird. So I've seen wonderful, I mean, these birds are in very good numbers in Manipur also, in Shiru Hills especially. So it's not that difficult. Even Mizoram, they were in very good numbers. So as we know, this is Ceylon frog mouth. So this one was also, we were looking for basically spot-bellied eagle owl in the night. When we came back, we saw this bird perched on this horizontal branch. And as we know, most of, some of you might have noticed, like all these nocturnals, in the daytime, they will be like with their eyes closed and like with like very, you know, sleepy mode, right? But in the night, they come so lively. Like I have never seen a frog mouth like this. With like, you know, in the daytime, it, you cannot see small plumes and all coming out. In the night, they're so lively. So I think it's a good thing if we can see it in the night. You know, the difference is so evident. You know, when they are in the night, they are like so alive and so alert, and it's beautiful to make them. The different, the feeling is so different when you see them in the night.
Jenny, ma'am, one again technical question. When you talk about the night photography and especially the frog mouths, you prefer any particular time zone? I mean, say immediately after the sunset or
yes. That is very important. What I have heard is, and what I have known from my experience is that we should start looking for the bird just after the nightfall. Like for example, like, you know, now we have the sunset at 5:30-ish, 5:40, right? So immediately around 6 o'clock, whatever, just after 15, 20 minutes, when it's like just the light disappearing and then and the dark is just settling, I think that is the time we should start. We should be at the spot that time. And then, you know, give it some more, like, you know, 10, 15 minutes more, and then slowly know the forest, feel the forest, and then hear for any calls, then slowly try. That is how I think I have found all the Naijas as well as frog mouths and the owls. Like it is like, you know, like around 6:30, 7. Like in the northeast, it will be around 5:30, 6. You know, it's like because the dark, just the onset of the dark and probably into 15, 20 minutes into it. It's not that I have seen it, I have not seen it later. That's not what I'm telling, but our search for it should start at around that time. Then only we will get like around a couple of hours to really kind of spot it and make a photograph. We need to really give a lot of time. Sometimes it's about 5 to 6 hours. So there was a case for when I was looking for the spot-bellied eagle owl in Manas. We saw it. I mean, I wanted to see the spot-bellied eagle owl from south and from the northeast also. It's a little bit size difference. So I wanted to see, you know, to make sure that I've seen both the species. Sometimes you have this kind of thing, right? Okay, I need to see this from the south as well as in the north. I wanted to do that. So I've tried for this eagle owl many times in the northeast. So I've heard this call like well before. But the point is that, you know, we were not able to make a picture till like around 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock in the night. Like 9:30, 10. That in the northeast, when you start searching for it from around 5:30 to 10:30, it's about good 5 hours. So sometimes it happens. So we have to be really patient with the nocturnals, I think. Now, then, yeah, some bird frames which I really like. So even though it's a very black bird, as the name suggests, I really like this, you know, the yellow flowers lighting up the bird and gives a unique background. So I really put some pictures which I really like, the frames that way. Then this one, it's like, you know, one of the most commonest starlings which we can see, endemic starlings which we can see in the south, in Dandeli, as well as in Kerala, in Thattikad and all that. But this famous fruiting trees of Dandeli gives such amazing pictures that this is one of my favorite ones. Like, you know, just really gives that very low light or something. You know, the condition was such. Then this one, the pink-browed rose finch from Chitkul. Chitkul is one of the best places to make good pictures of the pink-browed rose finch. All the rose finches, for example, the rose, the beautiful rose finch, the common rose finch, the pink-browed, all these rose finches are very good out there. And all small birds like nuthatches, winter wren, gold crest. I've seen my first, my life for it was from Chitkul. It's, they have like very beautiful fields for the people who have not gone there. So like field kind of birding, though it's a high altitude, that it's almost level walk. So you can walk and spend time and you get like very beautiful pictures of the Himalayan ruby throat. All that, it's very less populated and good to go around and explore in those fields. Maybe you can come back with very good pictures, especially like in June, in the bloom. So you can see, make some wonderful frames if you really are looking for some unique frames. Then hoopoe, it's a common bird in Ladakh especially. I've seen it in different forms, but you know, I felt like, you know, this frame is so dear to me because of the complementary colors of the you know, the sea buckthorn berry and the light colors on its head, crown feathers. So I really like this frame. Then Pudi Shaldak, another common bird which we see generally in the northeast in the winters, and also in Ladakh they breed there. But in this kind of setting, it's anybody's dream. Maybe like, you know, it was like, I was so happy to see it in a small kind of lake which is about to freeze in the winter. So it was like in Tawang, near Tawang, and it is complete blizzard that day. And you know, the bird was walking on the ice, you know, kind of on the snow actually. So I felt it's like really, really, very, very soothing frame. So one of the another frame which of which I made was like of the white-browed rosefinch at the same place, a little bit closer place. So it was completely covered with snow. We had a real tough time to get to Tawang. It was full of snow, and like we could not see anything. Fog, like, you know, it was not like even like a meter. It was not visible. That way it was. So it was. But you know, sometimes you get such good frames in that conditions. Then this another one, one of our beautiful birds in the country. So I felt like of all the throgons, this is one of the easiest throgon if they decide to perch. If you do not get it, we do not get it. But if you get it, and if you are careful to approach it, it can sit for like 2 hours in the same place. That is how that day we got that. But that kind of sighting I had only once. But I felt that red-headed throgon is very, very fidgety. Such a kind of, you know, very restless bird. But what throgon I felt, you know, they will sit, you perch at the place if you are like very careful and do not move much around. They're very curious and they give a very good shots. So this particular sighting, it was also in this was in May actually, yeah. So once I have seen about 6 throgons, but I concentrated only on one. This one was only one. So it's a trade-off that we do. Sometimes I really opt for smaller lenses, you know, because when you see like 4 or 5 birds, you know, you can try to get them. And those pictures are also very, very beautiful. But yeah, sometimes I feel like carrying all that, but then it becomes like too much for me. So I only carry one finally. Then the golden babbler in the habitat, we get a sense of space and habitat. So like it's like a bright yellow gem in the green forest. Crossbill is another bird which I have really, really struggled to get. But then of late I found that in winter, Singalila National Park, if you go, you have a fair chance of getting it. Crossbill otherwise is a very random bird, you know. It could appear anywhere. It was seen in Mandala on the pine tree treetops. Then it used to be seen in Sikkim, in Pangulaka, everywhere. I've seen it in many places, but if you are looking for it to make a good image, then probably you will not see them. You know, their migration pattern and the way they flock around, or maybe in search of the food, maybe because of the availability of the food, whatever it is, it's very, very difficult to place an exact location for them. But this is a sort of a fair location for them. Like April, March to April probably is a good time to make very good images. They come to feed in the small pine trees in the top. and a single lila top. So you can just be around and then try to make good shots. Even beautiful rose fringe is also very good there. This is one of my favorite shots, and the bird also, I like its hairdo and the light falling on it. So it's like the lesser rufous headed parrot built from Namdapa. Another one, the yellow cheeked, black spotted yellow tit. And peregrine falcon, this is one of the fluke shot which had happened because they were supposed to come to a lake in Jaisalmer, near Ramgarh, actually in Jaisalmer district, Netsi Lake. I don't know whether you've been there, Amit, have you been there?
No.
Okay, so this place is supposed to be like, you know, good for black-bellied sand grouse and the spotted sand grouse. Not every year they get a sighting, but some years they get a sighting. So black-bellied sand grouse, I think it's one of the only sites which have been, which we have as a reliable site as of now. Not every year, but probably like, you know, 1 or 2 years they will come up. So our plan was to get settled near the lake bed and to try taking shots of these birds when they come to drink water. And they have that particular time to drink water. So you have to be you have to make sure that you are not very visible for them. So we were lying on the lake bed to get the shots and all that of the black-bellied sand grouse. I think I should show you one image later. So anyway, we were able to see the black-bellied sand grouse, and then we tried for spotted sand grouse. We didn't see it. Then again, like, you know, after some time, couple of weeks, the guide Musa, I think he was like what is his name? I forgot. Sorry, not been birding for a long time. Uresh Khan. Urad was coming. Sorry for that. So Uresh Khan, he is a very good birder there, you know, a very nice person. So he called me and told me that, ma'am, it is seen. Can you please try to come? I was not very sure, but still, you know, sometimes you take their word. You trust them, you know. Yeah. So I went again after like, you know, two, three weeks rather, again to the spot. And then 3-4 days I was lying in the same place early in the morning for the spotted sand grouse to come. I didn't see it. 4th day I saw it anyway. I thought it was chestnut-bellied sand grouse coming in, but it was spotted sand grouse coming in. And anyway, we made some shots, ID shots only. It's very far, you know, they sense somehow, even if you are like, you know, lying down on the lake bed, they really know that, you know, something is there. So they try to go the other side or here side. They will not come near you. So anyway, finally made that image. And the next season onwards, it was seen very good in GRK, in the Lodia village near GRK. I went and made satisfactory pictures from that. But that was a good sighting. When you see it as a lifer for the first time, that up to 3-4 days, it's a good thing. So after I shot the sand grouse, then I saw this big flock of the chestnut-bellied sand grouse coming in. Then, you know, this peregrine falcon, it just looped, dived into the flock, caught one, then decapitated it. Oh. Then it all happened in split second, you know. It's like, you know, I am watching all this through my lens, you know, in between clicking, and I was not sure, just completely against the light. So I didn't get time to really kind of change the setting. These are the kind of moments when you kind of get frozen, right? You don't know what is happening, and then you want to see the spectacle. And so I was watching all that. And what happened was that fortunately, the bird, instead of flying that side, it just came into my side. And it's a lake bed, right? And then I'm standing and I have a huge area to pan the bird. So that is how this got in focus. But whatever it is, I'm so happy. And the sand, the drama was like very, very, one of the first kind which I have seen in the wild. Like this, you know, a falcon really hunting into the flock, and how fast it is. Within split seconds, it happens and flies off as well. So that is how this shot was made.
And thanks to all the skills.
Thanks
to all skills what you acquired over a period of time.
Amit,
you know, watching the bird through the camera and then freezing that moment. Then it's a congratulations for the shot. It's amazing.
Amazing, yeah, amazing.
It's a 1000 500 on 2x anvil.
Wow.
Yeah.
How did you ever focus it?
I don't know. That is what sometimes I feel, that's a fluke kind of thing. But this one, I'm sure that I got an area to pan, because I was focusing the bird right from the drama started unveiling. You know, it was against the light. And when it came like in eye level, the settings became perfect. Had I changed that, then I would have missed this. You know, it would have been blighted shot. So I didn't do anything. I just, because I didn't do anything, I think it was like kind of, it was a blessing in disguise. So it just came in front of me, that is how I shot it. And that's one of the most unforgettable sightings, you know, of the fastest animal on the earth hunting was something like, you know, a sight to behold. So this is a white-breasted swallow. I like this image because they were hunting for the grub in the rain and the drizzle and all. That time I didn't have too much like in my mind that, you know, this frame would be good. But, you know, naturally we all have the propensity towards something like different, you know, or I catches something unique and beautiful. So that is how I made this image. It's a very old shot. I think it's like taken using Canon with the 300 f/4. Okay. But I really feel it so happy when I see this image now. And this is like, you know, our hornbills from Dandeli. And this is Mrs. Gold's sunbird. And like, you know, trying to preen on what I was quite, because I was including the space or nothing like that. I was quite far, but I don't know what it was doing. It was like showing all the colors on it, on the bird. It's very nice to see that. Yeah. Then another one, Lammergeier head on in Spiti Valley. Then wall creeper, another fluke shot. It just somehow got focused. So you know how it flies, and you know, just, you know, I just got kind of lucky with that. And this one, just, you know, I like the frame. And Andaman tails, yeah, that was also like through a small gap, I could focus this. And Amur falcon and black, Indian black ibis. I like the frame. This was also from the Netsi Lake. Same when I was shooting the peregrine falcon, all shot on the same day. You know, that day, the bird life was so beautiful there. Like, starting from the water pipit, then common ringed plover. And since you're lying down there, then you have like, you know, some birds coming near also. It was very difficult, very easy to make such kind of pictures. So I found out that, you know, when you spend a lot of time in a particular spot, when some activity happens, then you can really make some unique pictures. If you're really up for it. Yeah. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Wonderful opportunity. I'm sure that I've overshot the time. I think it's like, if you're not kind of editing it, then I think it's going to be a problem. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jenny. And it was wonderful seeing your images. And more than that, your experience, how you achieved it. It will be a big lesson to the birding community. In all, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Keep inspiring, Jenny ma'am. As I always said, you know, if someone comes with us and say ki yaar trekking karna padega or 2 kilometer chalna padega, I always, your picture comes to my mind. You know, I mean, look at her. I mean, how she is doing it. So you are really a big inspiration. So keep walking, keep birding, keep shooting, and keep inspiring us. And guys, thank you so much. Hit that like button, subscribe button. We wanted to achieve that magic figure of 1,000 subscribers, guys. And thank you, Jenny, for this beautiful session. And wish you all the very best. Thank you, guys.